So the reason why we are grasping with attachment is because we think things are real and solid and always going to be the way they are. And we don't understand how much we project our outer and inner reality. So that it's always compared to mirage, rainbows, and so forth. All these things which come up and are very apparent, but depend on causes and conditions, sunlight, moisture in the air, and so forth, so that you can never grasp it. It's real on one level. Everybody, oh, look at the rainbow, everybody sees rainbow. But if we look for the rainbow, we never can find it. So this is why it is again and again, these kind of illusions, dreams and mirages, rainbows and so forth, are used to give people the idea that on one level they are real, but on another ultimate level, you can never grasp the thing in itself. Like a movie. You know, I mean, a movie is there. We can all agree this is it, that's the plot. We all heard the same thing. But actually, if you try to grasp the actors, they're not there, right? They are depending on the projection of all these frames moving very, very fast and the light going through them, which demonstrates the mind very well, you know, that the thought moments are like little empty frames moving so fast, and then the pure, clear light of the nature of the mind shining through, it projects this whole seeming reality in front of us. And we can enjoy the movie, we can enjoy the projection, as long as we don't try to grasp it with attachment and hold on and cling on and believe the harder we hold on, the less likely it is that we will lose something. But in fact, if we hold it very lightly, we're much less, you know, things will be allowed to flow. And when they do lose, we can accept it. It's very important. I mean, this is something for all of us, because everybody, it's not just monks and nuns. Everybody needs to hold things more lightly. I mean, if we look at it like a butterfly, then if you hold the butterfly very gently, the butterfly will settle there. But if you go like that, oh, you're such a beautiful butterfly, no butterfly. We've killed it. We've killed the very thing that we want the most, because we are grasping too tightly. So we kill the very happiness which we are seeking, because by holding on so tightly, we're so afraid to lose. That's why liberation comes from letting go. Doesn't mean you all have to become sadhus. It's not an external renunciation. It's an internal allowing things just to be and holding them gently, caringly, lovingly, but not with this tight mind, which is terrified of letting go. So that's why he says, without attachment. You see, people mistake attachment and love. I mean, we're always going on about this. People think that the more they hold on to somebody tightly, the more it proves that they love them. But if we're holding on to people very tightly, what it really means is, I love you and therefore I want you, because you are going to make me happy. Right? So always attachment is saying, I love you, therefore you make me happy. Whereas genuine love is saying, I love you, therefore I want you to be happy. And if that includes me, that's nice. And if it doesn't include me, it doesn't matter so much, because your happiness is what counts. So I often say, when I first was coming to India when I was 20, then, so my mother, she was a widow, and she had my brother and me, these two children to bring up. And my brother was older than me, and he was in the Royal Air Force, so he was in Malaysia. And so there was only myself and my mother at home. And my mother had by this time also become Buddhist. And so we had a lot to share together. You know, we would go together to the various Buddhist meetings and meet with the lamas and so forth. She was very, very interested in my spiritual path and made it her spiritual path too. And so there were just the two of us at home. And then there was a school for young incarnate lamas in Dalhousie in Himachal Pradesh, and I wanted to join that. And then I got a letter saying, yes, please come. So I remember running through the streets to meet my mother. She was coming from work. And I said to her, oh, I'm going to India. And she said, oh, yes, dear. And when are you leaving? She didn't say, oh, you can't go to India and leave me, your poor mother, all alone. What am I going to do if you leave me? She didn't talk like that. Why? Because she loved me. And she knew I wanted to come to India. So she just said, when are you leaving? And then for a time she came to India later and stayed about a year. And then I stayed in India that time about 11 years. And then she wrote and said, if you come back, if I send you a return ticket, will you come back for 1 month? So then every 10 years I would go back for 1 month, see my mother, come back to India. And never did she say, look, I'm getting old, I'm all alone, when are you coming home? And she told people, she told some friends of mine, that she always prayed that in her next lifetime she would come back again as my mother, because she was concerned otherwise I would have parents who didn't understand that I needed to lead a special sort of life. Now that's love. It's not easy, but it's genuine. She was concerned with my happiness. Her happiness came from my happiness. So this is what he's talking about. You know, it's not a lack of love, but it's love without that grasping mind. The clinging is what causes the suffering, and which keeps us in bondage. So, may you all be very well and happy and practice to the best of your abilities. Are there any questions? Could you explain in brief, it's going to be very brief, are the differences between Tantra in Tibetan Buddhism and Tantra in Hinduism? Well, I will quote my own Lama Kamtar Rinpoche. When he was living in Kalimpong, then he met with a number of Hindu tantrikas there and discussed with them. And he said that essentially, there, as far as the practice goes, there was not that much difference. The difference was in motivation. That the tantrikas he met did not have bodhicitta. In other words, they were not practicing in order to gain enlightenment, to come back endlessly in order to liberate all beings. The reason why Tantra got a bad reputation where it traveled, except in Tibet, due to people like Atisha, who kept pushing bodhicitta, 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 was because it tends to become a power trip. And that people gain a lot of power positively or negatively. But without genuine compassion, then it's very dangerous. And this is why also traditionally in Tibet, there is a lot of work first on purifying your motivation so that you're really practicing not for the sake of yourself, but for the sake of all beings, in order to benefit all beings everywhere. So I would say that was the basic real difference. Other than that, a lot of the methods and even the texts sound really fairly similar. For example, Dr. Bettina Bauer, who teaches on the Kashmiri Shaivite Tantras, she's been doing a lot of research into it, and it's very similar to many of the Buddhist Tantras, with this exception of the emphasis which the Buddhists had gave it of, you know, why are we practicing, and that it has to be in order to wake up for the sake of all beings, not just in order to get more power and control over those beings. Oh, Buddhists believe that not only in this solar system that you can get enlightened. Oh dear. Oh God, we're going to be here till midnight. I'll try and hurry it up. Okay, sorry. That you can get enlightened. If you have a chance to be enlightened as a Buddha, would you like to come back to this world? What to do? Here we have vowed. Yes, I mean, of course, we believe that the whole cosmos is filled with sentient beings, and that in many, many realms of the solar system, there are also filled with Buddhas turning the wheel of the Dharma and so forth. It's not just in this particular little human realm that this is happening. So, but normally, karmically, we are attached to a certain solar system. So for that reason, normally we would get reborn within this particular world, rather than get reborn in another world system where they have their own karmic cycles. Kundavinaya Sutra of Tibetan Buddhism, can monks and nuns touch and hug with the opposite gender? Well, traditionally, no. According to Vinaya Sutra, which of course is the Mula Svastavada, which came from India, monks and nuns, the point is monks and nuns are not allowed to touch each other with minds filled with desire. That's the point. So since normally you can't know whether your mind is full, somebody else's mind is full of desire or not, therefore came the idea from custom, as in India, and in Asia, that males and females should not be seen touching. In Tibet, they were kind of casual, as His Holiness the Dalai Lama has proved to everybody. He's very huggy. And I have to say that those lamas from whom I've had the privilege of being hugged, you genuinely feel that you're being hugged by the bodhisattvas of compassion. There's no sense of any kind of sensual input in there at all. I mean, if there were, you'd run. You know, you just know that they are holding your hand or hugging you with just such purity. They, male, female doesn't mean anything. And in that way, you know, it's actually a step beyond worrying, oh, that's a male, you know, I mustn't go near it. You know, why? If it's just, you know, a sentient being, you know, like any sentient being, then there shouldn't be any differences. But of course, it depends on your society. I mean, in Thailand, of course, everybody's very shocked by His Holiness, because if, for example, a woman holds out some foreign journalist holds out her hand to have a handshake, he'll take her hand. And clearly he's not a monk, right? From their standards. But from the standards of other people who understand, they just feel so blessed to have that contact with somebody who just loves them, totally irrelevant of their gender. But in the Vinaya, yes, a monk or a nun is not allowed to touch a member of the opposite sex with a mind, either their mind or the opposite sex mind, filled with lust. Right? If they're not feeling lust either side, then it doesn't mention that that's anything wrong. In all the Vinaya, not just the Tibetan Vinaya. Oh, somebody's cheating here. I think of the Gautama Buddha as a great scientist who turned his gaze inward instead of outward, rather someone who wished to start a religion or a sect. Of course, I also think and experience the Dharma as a natural law alive in each one of us, guiding us in leading lives of nonviolence, equanimity, and moderation. Is this true of your experiences? And if so, why is it important to be ordained? Well, yes. I mean, I always think of Buddhism as enlightened common sense. Because, you know, most of the Dharma, if you think about it, were obvious. Right? And, of course, His Holiness the Dalai Lama is so fascinated by quantum physics and neurology because the discoveries that they are making are very much consistent with Buddhist philosophy and meditational experience. So, yes, I mean, most of Buddhism is totally rational and doesn't require any belief system. If you look at it, really, you can see that this is really true. Why did I become ordained? Because when I came to the Buddha Dharma, I wanted to give my whole life to this. I thought this is the most important thing in all the world. Nothing is more important. And as a nun or a monk, it cuts off so many outer distractions. You know, you are able to give your energies and your focus to study and practice in a way that if you have household, if you have a job, and if you have household commitments and romantic attachments and children you're worrying about, you can bring that onto the path, but nonetheless it is much more challenging than if you don't have to think about any of all that and you have ample time just to study and practice. And also I was absolutely 100% not interested in getting married. So as a result, here we are. Why do you say in Cave in the Snow we should not be anxious about death? Because if we lead a fairly decent life and we have done our best, then what is there to fear? We have died and been reborn and re-died and reborn and re-died and reborn endless times. We're endlessly being recycled, very ecologically sound. And if we, of course, if we are doing really nasty, awful, mean things and harming many, many beings, you have a lot to fear come death. But for the average person, as His Holiness again says, for the average person, if you'd led a fairly decent life and done the best you can, then there's nothing to fear. We just go on. The consciousness carries on. Most people, it's not death they fear, it's pain. So that, you know, to a large extent can be controlled nowadays. And in any case, when the time comes, you'll deal with it. You know, I mean, it's amazing what we can deal with when we have to. And meantime, death itself is totally natural. I mean, as Dumbledore said to Harry Potter, for one, he said, for one with a well-regulated mind, death is but the next great adventure. And it's true. Whenever I thought I was going to die, I've always thought, oh, this will be interesting. Now let's really see what happens. Everybody has their version. Now we'll find out. Right? It's exciting. Nothing to worry about. Oh, we're never going to get through this. How important is the voice? Mother Teresa also speaks of hearing the voice. You speak of it too. Can we all be privileged to hear of it? I mean, I don't know what voice Mother Teresa was hearing. I used to hear sometimes this male voice inside me telling me what to do or not to do or explaining things. I don't hear it anymore. I've lost contact. It would be very categorical and just tell me, and I'd always argue, and it would always say, just do it, you know. So I always assumed it was some kind of helpful spirit, like a kind of guardian spirit that from time to time had to tell me what to do. Otherwise, I would have gone off in some other direction. I can't deal with that one. I'm trying to find something which is relevant for everybody. I don't know, I could go on forever looking for something which is... So I hear she's just, as this is sort of relevant in general here, but I'm not quite sure what she wants or he wants. Please give your message to people who recently joined or taken the Dharma and many more who are now in Buddhism. We the people in Maharashtra have only one book which was written by the legendary Dr. Ambedkar, of course. His Buddha and Dharma for traditions and teachings to follow Buddhism. Well, alas, for the people of Maharashtra, of course, Dr. Ambedkar died far too young. And this was a great tragedy because he should have practiced and studied the Dharma longer than he could have written another book. One book is not enough to use as like a Bible to base all your understanding on. The Dharma is very vast. I think that what the people in Maharashtra need to do, those who have become Buddhists now, especially amongst the Dalit classes who are following Dr. Ambedkar, is to really study not just Dr. Ambedkar, but many other Buddhist texts, to get a somewhat wider view. I mean, Dr. Ambedkar was astonishing and a genuine bodhisattva, and he did so much for helping people, not just Buddhists, but with the constitution and everything like this. He was a wonderful, wonderful man, but he was only a man. He wasn't a Buddha. And therefore, it is very important also to read the words of the Buddha and of other great teachers. And so those of you who know very well not only classical Marathi but also English very well could do well to start translating more of some of the main textbooks, you know, that are really so that people can read them in their own language and understand the vastness as well as the profundity of the Buddha Dharma. I think that this would be a great benefit for everybody. And then to invite teachers to come and teach and to be there to help. People are now trying to start to raise centers and so forth. And to give your cooperation for those sort of things would be very, very good so that the Dharma can come up again in Maharashtra. In spite of many great female teachers in Tibetan Buddhism, why are there no female tulkus and rinpoches born? Well, there is one or two, but not many. I one time asked my Lama come to Rinpoche, how come there are no female tulkus? Everybody knows what a tulku is? No. A tulku, in Tibetan tradition, when a master dies, if they die consciously, then they can also be reborn consciously. In other words, they can choose where they're going to be reborn, and often they leave notes beforehand explaining who they're going to be reborn to. And so when the master dies, then after a certain time, they look for the incarnation of that master. This worked very easily in old Tibet because everything stayed the same and nothing changed for centuries and centuries. So you could easily look around all the various villages till you found the one you're looking for. So I asked my Lama, how come there were, you know, almost no female tulkus in Tibet? And he said that at her birth, his sister had more signs than he did. When a special being is being born, there are signs like rainbows in the sky, flowers falling, water in the offering bowls turning to milk, and so forth. Flowers blooming out of season, these type of signs. And so then people know some special being is going to be reborn. So he said that his sister had more signs at her birth than he did, and that everyone got very excited. Oh, who's coming? But then when it was a girl, they said, oops, mistake. And that was it. And he said, had she been a boy, then they would have taken good care, made sure, tried to find out who he was, or at least made sure he was properly trained, put in with good teachers and a good monastery, etc., etc. As it was a girl, nothing was done. And he said this was quite common. And these women, you know, in time they usually got married, and maybe when their family grew up and left home, then they would go off into retreat and maybe even gain accomplishment. He said, but by that time it's too late. Because they had no training and no education, they couldn't help others. They couldn't really teach others. So he said, for that reason, not because male or female, it makes any difference as far as spiritual progress is concerned, but because from being reborn as a female was a disadvantage in that there was no training available for females. Therefore, they would choose not to come back as a female. For example, his own Dalai Lama, because, you know, journalists always ask him, will you come back as a girl next time? He often says, yes, well, if that's useful, I can come back as a female. But he knows perfectly well that if he did come back as a female, even if all the indications were there, they would not recognize him. I mean, all those hundreds of thousands of monks down south, they don't want a woman as their spiritual guide. So he knows perfectly well. I mean, from his side, male or female is irrelevant. But he knows very well that the society would not take it. And so if you are a female, even I know many girls who were daughters, the only option as a female would be to be reborn as the daughter of a high lama. And some high lamas have only daughters. Then you have a chance. But even they say it was very hard. All the information, all the teaching, all the training was given to the sons. The girls were groomed to make a good dynastic marriage to some other high lama, right? And unite the lama families. And that's all that they were meant for. And the fact that they themselves had great desire for study and practice was, you know, ignored. They all had to struggle, even if they were the daughters of very high lamas. So there is one or two who broke through that. But in general, it's because of that, because society was not geared to take women practitioners seriously. But that is changing. If human life is so precious and the results of good deeds in the past, then why has human population got still so many bad deeds? Well, you know, we are still very immersed in ignorance. And also, we don't know for many of the population of this world where they came from last time, right? The world is increasing. And it doesn't mean that when we get reborn, we always get reborn in the human realm. So we don't know where this surplus of human population, what they were last time. And maybe people who are especially purified have gone on to us. The world is also full of a lot of goodness. I think it's very important to remember that there is goodness far outweighs evil. But we only read about the bad stuff because that is considered news. So, I mean, even like the recently there was a huge demonstration, I forget what it was for, but it was for some like peace rally or something like this. 200,000 people marching peacefully. But in the corner, there was a little skirmish with just a dozen people who had nothing to do with that at all and were just coming in to make a little bit of trouble. That got the headlines. And nobody mentioned the 200,000 who were just marching peacefully. All the television, all the cameras, click, 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 on this little side issue, which had nothing to do with the march. And so that's the problem. We get distorted news. All the goodness that people are doing in this world doesn't get reported. But you do something bad and you hit the front page. And so that gives people the idea that there's only bad things going on, which, you know, is simply not true. There's a lot of goodness going on. Perhaps it's good that bad news is still news. When bad news is no longer news, then we're in trouble. But there's a lot of goodness in the world, a lot of good people. And even if sometimes people make mistakes, the average person has good intentions. So, you know, but to really overcome our negative emotions takes work. And most people are not willing to put the work in to do it. If they do, maybe they go somewhere else, who knows. But anyway, I don't think we're getting any worse. We might not be getting much better, but we're not getting worse. We're working on it, you know. I mean, our time on this planet working on spiritual issues is so small compared with the vastness of evolution. And so, you know, this is just a very short transit period in which we're still trying to develop ourselves into decent human beings. But most people are good. Most people's basic motivations are kind. They would rather be kind than cruel. So don't despair. In the beginning stages, what practices can one do to befriend the mind so it begins to cooperate with us? Well, I mean, I think this shamatha practice of calming the mind by looking at the breath, and then as we begin to settle the mind, also looking at the mind, but also practices like loving kindness and compassion and empathetic joy, etc., which, as the Buddha recommended, we start first by giving to ourselves. If we really give ourselves genuine loving kindness and compassion before cultivating it for others, then this also helps us to get through, to befriend the mind, to make the mind recognize that, you know, if it is peaceful and kind, we will, it's okay. We have to forgive ourselves. And whatever negativities we have in our mind, we have to work with those. And so all these basic practices, Tonglen also, you can do Tonglen on yourself. Visualizing, maybe in a difficult period in your life, visualizing yourself and taking in the negativities and sending out again this light of our true genuine nature. Any of these helps to us to overcome this sense of alienation from our true nature and encourages the mind to cooperate on the path so that it wants to walk on the path. And is not, we're not always whipping ourselves and criticizing ourselves and undercutting ourselves. Can Tonglen be used for emotional issues as well? Well, if people have very, like if people are very depressed, yes, definitely. Or they're very angry, or they're feeling very revengeful, or they're having a lot of emotional upsets. Definitely, definitely. Well, you have to come to Himachal. How do we spend time with you again? Well, if we have an expectation of receiving gratitude from a person to whom we have been helpful, then does our action of being helpful have an underlying ulterior motive? And is there any action without a motive? Well, basically, all our actions which stem from the ego have a motive. Motive in itself is neither, I mean, we can have good motivations. Motive in itself is not a bad thing. It depends whether our motivations are good or our motivations are negative. But if we have no ego, then there is no motive. Our actions are spontaneously skillful. However, the thing is that very often, if we are kind to people and try to help them, there is this underlying expectation that they will be grateful. We might not think about that. We might not say to ourselves, well, you should be grateful for this. Look how kind I'm being. But nonetheless, we see that that is so when they are not grateful, right? When they turn around and do something which really hurts us after all our efforts on their behalf, then we see that it might not have been the main motive. Our main motive might have really been just to benefit them. But there is that underlying egoic desire that they should appreciate what we've done. Right? That's all it's saying. So, I mean, that doesn't mean that therefore we shouldn't help people, because that would be egoic. But it does mean that we that person, by not being grateful and appreciating us, is highlighting the fact that our motives were actually quite mixed and were not as totally altruistic as we would like to believe they were. That there is a little bit of self-clinging there too. And to accept that, not beat ourselves up about it, accept it, but be grateful because they've shown us that. You know, that we're not nearly as altruistic as we would like to believe ourselves to be. That's all. I mean, it's important not to keep getting into a twist about the whole thing, you know, so that we anguish about everything we do, what is my genuine motivation behind all this, et cetera, et cetera. Then we just end up becoming very tight. And that's not the point either. How do you learn to accept and let things go? And how do we make acceptance easy? I mean, how do we let go? Well, we let go by letting go. There's no how, right? So we start, as with all things, with something fairly easy. I would like that last chocolate. Okay? Here, would you like the chocolate? Right? I mean, as an example, just something we notice that there is greed and grasping, and so we notice that and we do the opposite. Right? So as we're learning to play an instrument, we start with very easy scales. And we build up. So we start with simple letting go of very simple things, and then gradually we can let go of more essential things which, you know, we would rather cling on to. Letting go doesn't mean that we have to give everything away. It just means inwardly we let go. That there is this inner release. Not that necessarily outwardly we have to give everything we own away. The point is that what we have to ask ourselves is, if we lost something, how would we feel about it? if right now you got a call saying, sorry, your whole house has gone on fire, what would you think? That's the point, you know, that old story about the king and his guru, right? I mean, the king had so much and he was totally unconcerned. The guru only had a bowl and he was frantic that he was going to burn up in the palace. So this is the question. It's not what you own, but how much what you own owns you, right? Who's possessing who here? And very often it's our possessions that possess us rather than we're possessing the possessions. But if we hold them lightly and we enjoy them while we've got them, but if we lost them, then no big deal. Then we're free. That's the point. Inwardly, we can let go. Outwardly, it seems like we have much, but inwardly, we're holding it lightly. That's the point. This person says, by nature, I am an emotional person. When it comes to dealing with my own siblings, I become very emotional as they don't understand my feelings and what should I do? Well, I mean, I think it would be helpful to learn to be more mindful. Because in mindfulness, when emotions come up, we don't immediately just jump straight in. It allows us an inner space in which to decide which reactions and responses are helpful and which are not helpful. And so, therefore, as we become more mindful, we are also able to pause. The reason we don't pause and we just jump straight in is because our minds are very distracted and caught up in all our feelings and our thoughts. As we begin to make some inner space between our thoughts and feelings and emotions and that awareness of the thoughts and feelings and emotions, which is called mindfulness, then it allows us to give much more skillful responses and not just be, as it were, submerged in the waves of our emotions. You know, waves, they come up and then they suck you down, then they throw you up, then they suck you down. Now you're going to have a boat which is going to ride the waves. There was this t-shirt in Malaysia which had big waves, and on top of the waves was a surfboard, and on top of the surfboard was someone sitting in meditation, and it's the slogan said, riding the waves of life, be mindful, be happy. And so that's it, you know. I mean, a good surfer enjoys big waves, but they can ride them. They're not submerged by them. So it's not that we have to get rid of all our emotions, but we should be the rider of the emotions and not have the emotions ride us. And for that, the simplest way to deal with that is through cultivating mindfulness. One more question, then I'll let you all go. Okay? Promise. I have these questions in my mind. Who am I? Where have I come from? What is my duty? Where have I to go? How to get the answers to all these questions? Please guide. I would say, just sit and look at your breath. Because the mind proliferates endless questions. Never stops. And in the end, it cannot be answered by our conceptual mind, right? The conceptual mind is what's asking the questions. It will not receive Because whatever answers you will get more questions and more questions. You only get the answers from a silent mind. Our genuine mind, in the silence, knows the answers. It doesn't come in words. But we have to listen. And the only way to do that is to quieten down the mind, and then you can put the question and let it just percolate down through the silence of the our inner being, and the answer will come that way. If we are just going to endless talks and thinking, the mind just goes around like this. Of course, it doesn't mean that we cannot read books, we cannot attend teaching for the answers. But however many questions are answered, there will be more questions. It doesn't end that way. The only real answers comes from within us, from our own wisdom mind. And that is a very silent mind. Okay, so thank you all very much for all your questions. I do appreciate them, and I apologize for those I haven't answered. Maybe I should just deal with it. I think this is all the same person. She keeps asking, or he keeps asking the same sort of thing, and I don't know what they're getting on about. Living in samsara, can we meet God? Is that possible? How do I meet God in the easiest way or pathway? And so forth. Well, first of all, I'm not sure what they mean by God. How do I meet God? What is that experience like? Please give me your experience-based views and share with me. I left that out because I don't know what they mean by God. But if they mean, ultimate reality, then ultimate reality lies within us. It's not something you're going to meet just walking down the road. It's our own true being. It's like, in that way, if you want to think of a pathway, then, you have to open the door within. And so all these practices and all these methods are means for us to, first of all, deal with our conceptual mind and our ordinary conditioned reactions so that we don't cause too much harm, and gradually we begin to tame our mind and train it. But eventually we have to, as it were, transcend it. And if we can genuinely open up to a level of pure awareness within us, primordial awareness, not the ordinary conceptual mind or just the mindfulness which sees that, but beyond even that, then that is really, as far as I can see, what you could call God, because it doesn't belong to me, it doesn't belong to you or you or you. It's universal and all-pervading, but it is also all-knowing and all-compassionate. And so for this reason, in Buddhism, it is likened to the nature of the Buddha and is therefore called our Buddha nature. And it is our ultimate mode of being, which, like the sky in the monsoon season, is covered with clouds, so we don't see the sky. But the sky is always there. Of course, there could be no clouds if there was no sky. Space is everywhere. And so likewise, the nature of the mind is all pervading and it's always present, but normally we are so busy thinking and relating that we cannot even recognize our own level of pure awareness, which is there the whole time, but which normally we cannot access. So from that point of view, I would say that's how you meet God. I mean, you meet God within. All religions agree that it's not somebody up in the sky there. you know, it's within the nature of the mind, you know, but we are mostly looking in the wrong place. That's our delusion. But this God is very patient. He's waiting. She's waiting. It's waiting. So nam dia tam je se ba ni to ni ne ba to nam bon se ne je ga na je ba la du ba ye se ge so le do wa do wa shu a jam ba ba wo je do jam ba da kun du sam bo de an de jin de de da kun ji ju so da lo jing ge wa de da tan je ro tu mo chan ju san ju rin bo je ma je ba na je ju je je wa nyam ba me ba yang go ne gon du te wa shu One, just one more anecdote about Atisha, which is very well known. Paldan Atisha, as I say, he was a Bengali. He went to Tibet in the 11th century. And he brought with him his Indian attendant, who was absolutely awful. He was very rude, very uncooperative, always shouting at Atisha and complaining, and he was absolutely horrible. And so Atisha's students said, look, Rinpoche, why are you bothering with this awful man? We'll serve you. Guruji, we're longing to serve you. Why have you got this horrible being there? Send him back to India. And Atisha said, what are you talking about? You know, he's my guru. You're also kind to me. You know, I don't learn anything from you, but him. So, keep that in mind.
Hello. On behalf of all of us, Somaya, Yogihar, and Marlene, and Suruji, Supriya, everyone, and the entire audience, thank you very much.
Mr. Kapil, you need to take the tea.
Thank you.
No, I'm good.